with student teachers housed in barracks and subjected to harsh discipline and indoctrination. In 1890, the imperial rescript on education emerged. It laid down a code of ethics to govern not only students and teachers but every Japanese citizen. The rescript was the civilian equivalent of Japanese military codes, which valued above all obedience to authority and unconditional loyalty to the emperor. In every Japanese school, a copy of the rescript was enshrined with a portrait of the emperor and taken out each morning to be read. It was reputed that more than one teacher who accidentally stumbled over the words committed suicide to atone for the insult to the sacred document. By the 1930s, the Japanese educational system had become regimented and robotic. A visitor to one of its elementary schools expressed pleasant surprise at seeing thousands of children waving flags and marching in unison in perfect lines. Quite clearly, the visitor had seen the discipline and order but not the abuse required to establish and maintain it. It was commonplace for teachers to behave like sadistic drill sergeants, slapping children across the cheeks, hitting them with their fists, or bludgeoning them with bamboo or wooden swords. Students were forced to hold heavy objects, sit on their knees, stand barefoot in the snow, or ran around the playground until they collapsed from exhaustion. There were certainly few visits to the schools by indignant or even concerned parents. The pressure to conform to authority intensified if the schoolboy decided to become a soldier. Vicious hazing and a relentless pecking order usually squelched any residual spirit of individualism in him. Obedience was touted as a supreme virtue, and a sense of individual self-worth was replaced by a sense of value as a small cog in the larger scheme of things. To establish this sublimation of individuality to the common good, superior officers or older soldiers slapped recruits for almost no reason at all or beat them severely with heavy wooden rods. According to the author Iratani Toshio, officers often justified unauthorized punishment by saying, "I do not beat you because I hate you. I beat you because I care for you. Do you think I perform these acts with hands swollen and bloody in a state of madness?" Some youths died under such brutal physical conditions. Others committed suicide. The majority became tempered vessels into which the military could pour a new set of life goals. Training was no less grueling a process for aspiring officers. In the 1920s, all army cadets had to pass through the military academy at Ichigaya. With its overcrowded barracks, unheated study rooms, and inadequate food, the place bore a greater resemblance to a prison than a school. The intensity of the training in Japan surpassed that of most Western military academies. In England, an officer was commissioned after some 1,372 hours of DAS work and 245 hours of private study, but in Japan the standards were 3,382 hours of DAS work and 2,765 hours of private study. The cadets endured a punishing daily regimen of physical exercise and classes in history, geography, foreign languages, mathematics, science, logic, drawing, and penmanship. Everything in the curriculum was bent toward the goal of perfection and triumph. Above all, the Japanese cadets were to adopt a will which knows no defeat. So terrified were the cadets of any hint of failure that examination results were kept secret to minimize the risk of suicide. The academy was like an island to itself, sealed off from the rest of the world. The Japanese cadet enjoyed neither privacy nor any opportunity to exercise individual leadership skills. His reading material was carefully censored, and leisure time was non-existent. History and science were distorted to project an image of the Japanese as a super os. During these impersonable years, they have been walled off from all outside pleasures, interests, or influences, one Western writer observed of the Japanese officers. The atmosphere of the narrow groove along which they have moved has been saturated with a special national and a special military propaganda. Already from a race psychologically far removed from us, they have been removed still further. In the summer of 1937, Japan finally succeeded in provoking a full-scale war with China. In July, a Japanese regiment, garrisoned by treaty in the Chinese city of Tientsin, had been conducting night maneuvers near the ancient Marco Polo Bridge. During a break, several shots were fired at the Japanese in the darkness, and a Japanese soldier failed to appear during roll call. Using this incident as an excuse to exercise its power in the region, Japanese troops advanced upon the Chinese fort of Wanping, near the bridge, and demanded that its gates be opened so that they could search for the soldier. When the Chinese commander refused, the Japanese shelled the fort. By the end of July, Japan had tightened its grasp on the entire Tientsin Peking region, and by August the Japanese had invaded Shanghai. The Second Sino-Japanese War was no longer reversible, but conquering China proved to be a more difficult task than the Japanese anticipated. In Shanghai alone, Chinese forces outnumbered the Japanese Marines 10-1, and Chiang Kai-shek, leader of the nationalist government, had reserved his best troops for the battle. That August, while attempting to land 35,000 fresh troops on the docks of Shanghai, the Japanese encountered their first setback. A hidden Chinese artillery emplacement opened fire and killed several hundred men, including a cousin of the Empress Nagako. For months the Chinese defended the metropolis with extraordinary valor. To the chagrin of the Japanese, the Battle of Shanghai proceeded slowly, street by street, barricade by barricade. In the 1930s, Japanese military leaders had boasted and seriously believed that Japan could conquer all of mainland China within 3 months. But when a battle in a single Chinese city alone dragged from summer to fall, and then from fall to winter, it shattered Japanese fantasies of an easy victory. Here, this primitive people, illiterate in military science and poorly trained, had managed to fight the superior Japanese to a standstill. When Shanghai finally fell in November, the mood of the imperial troops had turned ugly, and many, it was said, lusted for revenge as they marched toward Nanking. 6W66KS0FT6RA0K The race to Nanking. The Japanese strategy for Nanking was simple. The Imperial Army exploited the fact that the city was blocked by water in two directions. The ancient capital lay south of a bend in the Yangtze River that first coursed northward and then turned to flow east. By converging upon Nanking in a semicircular front from the southeast, the Japanese could use the natural barrier of the river to complete the encirclement of the capital and cut off all escape. In late November, three parallel Japanese troops rushed toward Nanking. One force traveled west under the southern bank of the Yangtze River. Its troops poured into the Yangtze Delta through the Pmu Inlet northwest of Shanghai and along the Nanking-Shanghai Railway, where the Japanese Air Force had already blasted away most of the bridges. These troops were led by Nakajima Kesago, who had worked as a member. 6 weeks of terror. 37 of Japanese Army Intelligence in France, and later as chief of the Japanese secret police for Emperor Hirohito. Not much has been written about Nakajima, but what has been written is overwhelmingly negative. David Bergamini, author of Japan's Imperial Conspiracy, called him a small Himmler of a man, a specialist in thought control, intimidation and torture, and quoted others describing Nakajima as a sadist who packed for his journey to Nanking special oil for burning bodies. Even his biographer, Kimura Kanenri, mentioned that Nakajima had been described as a beast and a violent man. Another force readied itself for a bold amphibious assault across Taihu, a lake situated halfway between Shanghai and Nanking. This force moved west from Shanghai in a route south of Nakajima's troops. Directing the movement was General Matsui Iwane, a frail, slight, tubercular man with a tiny mustache. Unlike Nakajima, Matsui was a devout Buddhist from a scholarly family. He was also the commander-in-chief of the Japanese Imperial Army for the entire Shanghai-Nanking region. A third force traveled further south of Matsui's men and swerved northwest toward Nanking. Heading this force was Lieutenant General Yanagawa Heisuke, a bald short man with literary interests. Perhaps to a greater degree than most other Japanese involved in the rape of Nanking, his life during the invasion is veiled in mystery. According to his biographer, Sugawara Yutaka, the fascist clique that took control of the Japanese military had expelled Yanagawa from their ranks because he attempted to stop their 1932 coup. After his marginalization and demotion to the reserves, Yanagawa served as a commanding officer in China and performed great military achievements, including the surrounding of Nanking, but the military withheld his name and photograph from publication at the time. Thus Yanagawa was known to many in Japan as the Masked Shogun. little was spared on the path to Nanking. Japanese veterans remember raiding tiny farm communities where they clubbed or bonneted everyone in sight. But small villages were not the only casualties. Entire cities were razed to the ground. Consider the example of Sichuan, now called Suzhou, a city on the east bank of Taihu Lake. One of the oldest cities of China, it was prized for its delicate silk embroidery, palaces, and temples. Its canals and ancient bridges had earned the city its western nickname as the Venice of China. On November 19th, on a morning of pouring rain, a Japanese advance guard marched through the gates of Sichuan, wearing hoods that prevented Chinese sentries from recognizing them. Once inside, the Japanese murdered and plundered the city for days, burning down ancient landmarks and abducting thousands of Chinese women for sexual slavery. The invasion, according to the China Weekly Review, caused the population of the city to drop from 350,000 to less than 500. A British correspondent had the opportunity to record what was left of Pine River Sunkang, a suburban city of Shanghai, 9 weeks after the Japanese had passed through it. "There is hardly a building standing which has not been gutted by fire," he wrote. "Smoldering ruins and deserted streets present an eerie spectacle, the only living creatures being dogs, unnaturally fattened by feasting on corpses. In the whole of Sunkang, which should contain a densely packed population of approximately 100,000, I saw only 5 Chinese, who were old men, hiding in a French mission compound, in tears. Osaka takes command, but the worst was still to come." On December 7th, as the Japanese troops zeroed in on Nanking, General Matsui grew feverishly ill in his field headquarters at Sichuan, another flare-up of his chronic tuberculosis. The illness struck Matsui right when power shifted from his command to that of a member of the imperial family. Only 5 days earlier, Emperor Hirohito had promoted Matsui out of the action while dispatching his own uncle, Prince Asako Yasuhiko, to the front to replace him. Under the new order, Matsui would be in charge of the entire Central China Theater, while Asaka, a lieutenant general with a 30-year tenure in the military, would take responsibility as the new commander-in-chief of the army around Nanking. As a member of the royal family, Asaka possessed power that would override all other authority on the Nanking front. He was also closer to Lieutenant General Nakajima and General Yanagawa than to Matsui, because he had spent 3 years in Paris with them as a military intelligence officer. Little is known as to why Hirohito chose at this critical moment to give Asaka this position, though Bergamini believes it was done to test Asaka, who had sided with the emperor's brother Chichibu against Hirohito on a political issue during the February 1936 army mutiny. On the palace rolls, Hirohito had singled out Asaka as the one member of the royal family who possessed an attitude that was not good, and apparently gave his uncle the appointment at Nanking as an opportunity to redeem himself. At the time, it seemed like a trivial change, but later, for the lives of hundreds of thousands of Chinese, it would prove to be a critical one. It is hard to describe what really happened behind the scenes in the Japanese army, because many of the details were given by Matsui and his colleagues years later at their war crimes trial, or by sources who may be unreliable, and they are therefore cited with caution. But if their testimony can be believed, this is what we learn. Wary of the imperial newcomer and the potential for abuse of power, Matsui issued a set of moral commandments for the invasion of Nanking. He ordered his armies to regroup a few kilometers outside the city walls, to enter the Chinese capital with only a few well-disciplined battalions, and to complete the occupation so that the army would sparkle before the eyes of the Chinese and make them place confidence in Japan. He also called a meeting of staff officers before his sect and proclaimed, "The entry of the imperial army into a foreign capital is a great event in our history, attracting the attention of the world. Therefore, let no unit enter the city in a disorderly fashion. Let them know beforehand the matters to be remembered and the position of foreign rights and interests in the walled city. Let them be absolutely free from plunder. Dispose sentries as needed. Plundering and causing fires, even carelessly, shall be punished severely. Together with the troops, let many military police and auxiliary military police enter the walled city and thereby prevent unlawful conduct. but events were brewing elsewhere, over which Matsui had no control. On December 5th, the story goes, Prince Asaka left Tokyo by plane and arrived on the front 3 days later. In an abandoned country villa near field headquarters, some 10 miles southeast of Nanking, Prince Asaka met with General Nakajima, his colleague from his Paris days, who was now recovering from a flesh wound in his left buttock. Nakajima told Asaka that the Japanese were about to surround 300,000 Chinese troops in the vicinity of Nanking and that preliminary negotiations revealed that they were ready to surrender. After Asaka heard this report, it was said that his headquarters sent out a set of orders, under his personal seal, marked secret, to be destroyed. We now know that the clear message of these orders was, kill all captives. What is not clear is whether Asaka himself issued the orders. *Choisamu, Asaka's staff officer for intelligence, later confessed to friends that on his own initiative, he had forged the order. Another Japanese officer, Tanaka Ryukichi, said that in April 1938, Joe, then the head of the 74th Wing of the Japanese Army, told him an interesting tale. Cho told him that when his troops landed at Hangzhou or Hangzhou Bay and pushed inland, nearly 300,000 Chinese troops were cut off from retreat, so they threw away their weapons and surrendered to the Japanese. To arrange for so many prisoners to feed them was a huge problem, Cho reportedly said. As the story goes, Cho seized upon a quick fix solution to eliminate the food problem. I immediately issued orders to all troops. We must entirely massacre these prisoners. Using the name of the military commander, I sent these orders by telegram. The wording of the order was to annihilate. We will never know if this story is true, but it must be noted that even if Cho had indeed forged the kill order on his own, this does not absolve Prince Asaka of responsibility for the massacre. Asaka could have issued an order to cancel the massacre once it started and court-martialed his intelligence officer. By the time Japanese troops entered Nanking, an order to eliminate all Chinese captives had been not only committed to paper, but distributed to lower echelon officers. On December 13, 1937, the Japanese 66th Battalion received the following command. Battalion battle reporter at 2 received order from the regiment commander. To comply with orders from brigade commanding headquarters, all prisoners of war are to be executed. Method of execution. Divide the prisoners into groups of a dozen. Shoot to kill separately. 3:30 p.m. A meeting is called to gather company commanders to exchange opinions on how to dispose of POs. From the discussion, it is decided that the prisoners are to be divided evenly among each company, 1 Sein, 2 NT, and 4 TH company, and to be brought out from their imprisonment in groups of 50 to be executed. 1 Sein company is to take action in the grain field south of the garrison. 2 ND company takes action in the depression southwest of the garrison. And 4 TIT company takes action in the grain field southeast of the garrison. The vicinity of the imprisonment must be heavily guarded. Our intentions are absolutely not to be detected by the prisoners. Every company is to complete preparation before 5. Executions are to start by 5 and action is to be finished by 7:30. There was a ruthless logic to the order. The captives could not be fed, so they had to be destroyed. Killing them would not only eliminate the food problem, but diminish the possibility of retaliation. Moreover, dead enemies could not form up into guerrilla forces. But executing the order was another matter. When the Japanese troops smashed through the walls in the early pre-dawn hours of December 13th, they entered a city in which they were vastly outnumbered. Historians later estimated that more than 500,000 civilians and 90,000 Chinese troops were trapped in Nanking, compared to the 50,000 Japanese soldiers who assaulted the city. General Nakajima knew that killing tens of thousands of Chinese captives was a formidable task. To deal with crowds of 1,000, 5,000, or 10,000, it is tremendously difficult even just to disarm them. It would be disastrous if they were to make any trouble. Killing the prisoners of war, because of their limited manpower, the Japanese relied heavily on deception. The strategy for Mass Butcher involved several steps, promising the Chinese fair treatment in return for an end to resistance, coaxing them into surrendering themselves to their Japanese conquerors, dividing them into groups of 1 to 200 men, and then luring them to different areas near Nanking to be killed. Nakajima hoped that faced with the impossibility of further resistance, most of the captives would lose heart and comply with whatever directions the Japanese gave them. All this was easier to achieve than the Japanese had anticipated. Resistance was sporadic. Indeed, it was practically non-existent, having thrown away their arms when attempting to flee the city. As the Japanese closed in, many Chinese soldiers simply turned themselves in, hoping for better treatment. Once the men surrendered and permitted their hands to be bound, the rest was easy. Perhaps nowhere is the passivity of the Chinese soldiers better illustrated than in the diary of the former Japanese soldier Azuma Shiro, who described the surrender of thousands of Chinese troops shortly after the fall of Nanking. His own troops were assigning sentry and billet in a city square when they suddenly received an order to round up about 20,000 prisoners of war. Azuma and his countrymen walked some 9 or 10 miles in search of the prisoners. Night fell, and the Japanese finally heard a rumbling, frog-like noise. They also saw numerous cigarette lights blinking in the darkness. It was a magnificent view, Azuma wrote. 7,000 prisoners all in one place, gathering around the two white flags attached to a dead branch, which flew in the night sky. The prisoners were a ragged assortment of men, wearing blue cotton military uniforms, blue cotton overcoats, and caps. Some covered their heads with blankets, some carried mat rush sacks, and some carried futons on their backs. The Japanese lined the prisoners up into four columns, with the white flag at the head. This group of thousands of Chinese soldiers had waited patiently for the Japanese to fetch them and direct them to the next step in the surrender process. The reluctance of the Chinese army to fight back stunned Azuma. To a man who came from a military culture in which pilots were given swords instead of parachutes, and in which suicide was infinitely preferable to capture, it was incomprehensible that the Chinese would not fight an enemy to the death. His contempt for the Chinese deepened when he discovered that the prisoners' numbers exceeded those of the captors. It was funny yet pitiable when I imagined how they gathered whatever white cloth they could find, attached it to a dead twig, and marched forward just to surrender, Azuma wrote. I thought, how could they become prisoners with the kind of force they had, more than two battalions, and without even trying to show any resistance? There must have been a considerable number of officers for this many troops, but not a single one remained, all of them having slipped away and escaped, one thought. Although we had two companies, and those 7,000 prisoners had already been disarmed, our troops could have been annihilated had they decided to rise up and revolt. A welter of emotions filled Azuma. He felt sorry for the Chinese soldiers, thirsty and frightened men, who constantly asked for water and reassurance that they would not be killed. But at the same time, their cowardice disgusted him. Azuma suddenly felt ashamed for ever having been secretly afraid of the Chinese in previous battles, and his automatic impulse was to dehumanize the prisoners by comparing them to insects and animals. They all walked in droves, like ants crawling on the ground. They looked like a bunch of homeless people, with ignorant expressions on their faces. A herd of ignorant sheep, with no rule or order, marched on in the darkness, whispering to each other. They hardly looked like the enemy, who only yesterday was shooting at and troubling us. It was impossible to believe that they were the enemy soldiers. It felt quite foolish to think we had been fighting to the death against these ignorant slaves, and some of them were even 12 or 13-year-old boys. The Japanese led the prisoners to a nearby village. Azuma recalled that when some of the Chinese were herded into a large house, they hesitated to enter, looking upon the place as if it were a slaughterhouse, but finally they gave in and filed through the gate. Some of the prisoners struggled with the Japanese only when the latter tried to take away their blankets and bedding. The next morning, Azuma and his comrades received an order to patrol another area. They later learned that while they were on patrol, the Chinese prisoners had been assigned to companies in groups of 200 to 300 then killed. Probably the single largest mass execution of prisoners of war during the Rape of Nanking took place near Mufu Mountain. The mountain lay directly north of Nanking, between the city and the south bank of the Yangtze River. An estimated 57,000 civilians and former soldiers were executed. The killing proceeded in stealth and in stages. On December 16, the Asahi Shimbun newspaper correspondent Yakuto reported that the Japanese had captured 14,777 soldiers near the artillery forts of Wulong Mountain and Myifu Mountain, and that the sheer number of the prisoners posed problems. The left bracket Japanese right bracket army encountered great difficulties since this was the first time that such a huge number of POWs were captured, Yakuto wrote. There were not enough men to handle them. According to Kuri Hararichi, a former Japanese army corporal who kept diaries and notes of the event, the Japanese disarmed thousands of prisoners, stripped them of everything but their clothes and blankets, and escorted them to a row of straw-roofed temporary buildings. When the Japanese military received orders on December 17 to kill the prisoners, they proceeded with extra caution. That morning the Japanese announced that they were going to transport the Chinese prisoners to Baguazhou, a small island in the middle of the Yangtze River. They explained to the captives that they needed to take special precautions for the move and bound the captives' hands behind their backs, a task that took all morning and most of the afternoon. Sometime between 4 and 6 p.m., the Japanese divided the prisoners into four columns and marched them to the west, skirting the hills and stopping at the riverbank. After 3 or 4 hours, waiting and not knowing what was going on, the prisoners could not see any preparations for crossing the river, the corporal wrote. It was then growing dark. They did not know that Japanese soldiers already encircled them in a crescent formation along the river, and they were in the sights of many machine guns. By the time the executions began, it was too late for the Chinese to escape. Suddenly all kinds of guns fired at once, Kuri Hararichi wrote. The sounds of these firearms mingled with desperate yelling and screams. For an hour the Chinese struggled and thrashed about desperately until there were few sounds still coming from the group. From evening until dawn, the Japanese bayoneted the bodies, one by one. Body disposal posed a mammoth problem for the Japanese. Only a fraction of the total number of men who perished in and around Nanking were slaughtered at Myifu Mountain, yet the cleanup there took days. Burial was one method of disposal, but General Nakajima complained in his diary that it was hard to locate ditches large enough to bury heaps of 7,000 to 8,000 corpses. Cremation was another, but the Japanese often lacked sufficient fuel to do a proper job. After the Myifu Mountain massacre, for instance, the Japanese poured large drums of gasoline on the bodies to burn them, but the drums ran out before fires could reduce the remains to ashes. The result was a mountain of charred corpses, a Japanese corporal wrote. Many bodies were simply dumped into the Yangtze River. The murder of civilians, after the soldiers surrendered en masse, there was virtually no one left to protect the citizens of the city. Knowing this, the Japanese poured into Nanking on December 13, 1937, occupy greater than NG government buildings, banks, and warehouses, shooting people randomly in the streets, many of them in the back, as they ran away. Using machine guns, revolvers, and rifles, the Japanese fired at the crowds of wounded soldiers, elderly women, and children who gathered in the North Chungshan and Central Roads and nearby alleys. They also killed Chinese civilians in every section of the city. Tiny lanes, major boulevards, mud dugouts, government buildings, city squares. As victims toppled to the ground, moaning and screaming, the streets, alleys, and ditches of the fallen capital ran rivers of blood, much of it coming from people barely alive, with no strength left to run away. The Japanese systematically killed the city dwellers as they conducted house-to-house searches for Chinese soldiers in Nanking. But they also massacred the Chinese in the nearby suburbs and countryside. Corpses piled up outside the city walls, along the river which had literally turned red with blood, by ponds and lakes, and on hills and mountains. In villages near Nanking, the Japanese shot down any young man who passed under the presumption that he was likely to be a former Chinese soldier. But they also murdered people who could not possibly be Chinese soldiers, elderly men and women, for instance, if they hesitated, or even if they failed to understand orders delivered in the Japanese language to move this way or that. During the last 10 days of December, Japanese motorcycle brigades patrolled Nanking, while Japanese soldiers shouldering loaded rifles guarded the entrances to all the streets of venues and alleys. Troops went from door to door, demanding that the doors be opened to welcome the victorious armies. The moment the shopkeepers complied, the Japanese opened fire on them. The Imperial Army massacred thousands of people in this manner, and then systematically looted the stores and burned whatever they had no use for. The Japanese journalists. These atrocities shocked many of the Japanese correspondents who had followed the troops to Nanking. A horrified Mainichi Shimbun reporter watched the Japanese line up Chinese prisoners on top of the wall near Chungshan Gate and charge at them with bayonets fixed on rifles. One by one the prisoners fell down to the outside of the wall, the reporter wrote. Blood splattered everywhere. The chilling atmosphere made one's hair stand on end and limbs tremble with fear. I stood there at a total loss and did not know what to do. He was not alone in his reaction. Many other reporters, even seasoned war correspondents, recoiled at the orgy of violence, and their exclamations found their way into print. From Imaima Satak, a Japanese military correspondent. On Ziaquan Wharves, there was the dark silhouette of a mountain made of dead bodies. About 50 to 100 people were toiling there, dragging bodies from the mountain of corpses and throwing them into the Yangtze River. The bodies dripped blood, some of them still alive and moaning. Weakly, their limbs twitching. The laborers were busy working, in total silence, as in a pantomime. In the dark, one could barely see the opposite bank of the river. On the pier was a field of glistening mud, under the moon's dim light. Wow, that's all blood. After a while, the coolies had done their job of dragging corpses, and the soldiers lined them up along the river. Rat-tat-tat machine gun fire could be heard. The coolies fell backwards into the river and were swallowed by the raging currents. The pantomime was over. A Japanese officer at the scene estimated that 20,000 persons had been executed. From the Japanese military correspondent Omoto Yukio, who saw Chinese prisoners brought to Ziaquan and lined up along the river. Those in the first row were beheaded, those in the second row were forced to dump the severed bodies into the river before they themselves were beheaded. The killing went on non-stop, from morning until night, but they were only able to kill 2,000 persons in this way. The next day, tired of killing in this fashion, they set up machine guns. Two of them raked across fire at the lined-up prisoners. Rat-tat-tat-tat. Triggers were pulled. The prisoners fled into the water, but no one was able to make it to the other shore. From the Japanese photojournalist Kawano Hiroki. Before the ceremony of entering the city, I saw 50 to 100 bodies drifting down the Yangtze River. Did they die in battle, or were they killed after being taken prisoner? Or were they slaughtered civilians? I remember there was a pond just outside Nanking. It looked like a sea of blood, with splendid colors. If only I had color film, what a shocking shot that would have been. Sasaki Motomasa, a Japanese military correspondent at Nanking, observed, I've seen piled up bodies in the great quake in Tokyo, but nothing can be compared to this. 6 weeks of terror. 49. The rape of Nanking. Next, the Japanese turned their attention to the women. Women suffered most. To Kikaro Kozo, a former soldier in the 114th Division of the Japanese Army in Nanking, recalled. No matter how young or old, they all could not escape the fate of being raped. We sent out coal trucks from Ziaquan to the city streets and villages to seize a lot of women. And then each of them was allocated to 15 to 20 soldiers for sexual intercourse and abuse. Surviving Japanese veterans claim that the army had officially outlawed the rape of enemy women. But rape remained so deeply embedded in Japanese military culture and superstition that no one took the rule seriously. Many believed that raping virgins would make them more powerful in battle. Soldiers were even known to wear amulets made from the pubic hair of such victims, believing that they possessed magical powers against injury. The military policy forbidding rape only encouraged soldiers to kill their victims afterwards. During an interview for the documentary, In the Name of the Emperor, Azuma Shiro, a former Japanese soldier, spoke candidly about the process of rape and murder in Nanking. At first we used some kinky words, like paikankan. Pai means hip, kankan means look. Paikankan means, let's see a woman open up her legs. Chinese women didn't wear underpants, instead they wore trousers, tied with a string. There was no belt. As we pulled the string, the buttocks were exposed. We pikankan. We looked. After a while we would say something, like it's my day, to take a bath, and we took turns raping them. It would be all right if we only raped them. I shouldn't say all right, but we always stabbed and killed them. Because dead bodies don't talk. Takakaro Kozo shared Azuma's bluntness in discussing the issue. After raping, we would also kill them, he recalled. Those women would start to flee once we let them go. Then we would bang. Shoot them in the back to finish them up. According to surviving veterans, many of the soldiers felt remarkably little guilt about this. Perhaps when we were raping her, we looked at her as a woman, Azuma wrote, but when we killed her, we just thought of her as something, like a pig. This behavior was not restricted to soldiers. Officers at all levels indulged in the orgy. Even Tony Hisao, the senior general earl and commander of the Japanese 6th Division, was later found guilty of raping some 20 women in Nanking. Some not only urged soldiers to commit gang rape in the city, but warned them to dispose of the women afterwards to eliminate evidence of the crime. Either pay them money or kill them in some out-of-the-way place after you have finished, one officer told his underlings. The arrival of Matsui Iwane, the killing and raping subsided when Matsui Iwane, still weak from his illness, entered the city on the morning of December 17th for a ceremonial parade. After recovering from his bout of tuberculosis, he traveled upriver on a naval launch and rode by car to the triple archway of the mountain gate on the east side of Nanking. There he mounted a chestnut horse, wheeled it to face the direction of the Imperial Palace in Tokyo, and led a triple banzai for the Emperor for Japan's National Radio Broadcasting Company. Great Field Marshal, on the steps of heaven, banzai, 10,000 years of life. He rode down a boulevard that was carefully cleared of dead bodies and flanked by tens of thousands of cheering soldiers, and arrived at the Metropolitan Hotel in the northern part of town, which held a banquet for Matsui that evening. It was sometime during this banquet, the record suggests, that Matsui suspected that something had gone terribly amiss at Nanking. That evening he called a staff conference and ordered all unnecessary troops transferred out of the city. The next day, the Western news media reported that the Japanese army was engaged in a giant conspiracy of silence against Matsui to prevent him from knowing the full truth of the Nanking atrocities. When Matsui began to comprehend the full extent of the rape, murder, and looting in the city, he showed every sign of dismay. On December 18, 1937, he told one of his civilian aides, I now realize that we have unknowingly wrought a most grievous effect on this city. When I think of the feelings and sentiments of many of my Chinese friends who have fled from Nanking and of the future of the two countries, I cannot but feel depressed. I am very lonely and can never get in a mood to rejoice about this victory. He even let a tinge of regret flavor the statement he released to the press that morning. I personally feel sorry for the tragedies to the people, but the army must continue unless China repents. Now in the winter, the season gives time to reflect. I offer my sympathy, with deep emotion, to a million innocent people. Later that day, when the Japanese command held a burial service for the Japanese soldiers who died during the invasion, Matsui rebuked the 300 officers, regimental commanders, and others on the grounds for the orgy of violence in the city. Never before Matsumoto, a Japanese correspondent wrote, had a superior given his officers such a scathing reprimand. The military was incredulous at Matsui's behavior because one of the officers present was a prince of imperial descent. By Sunday, December 19th, Matsui was moved to Osaka's headquarters outside the city and put on a destroyer the following day to be sent back to Shanghai. But once there he made an even more shocking move, one perhaps driven by desperation. He confided his worries to the New York Times and even told an American foreign correspondent that the Japanese army is probably the most undisciplined army in the world. Today, that month he also sent a bold message to Prince Osaka's chief of staff. It is rumored that unlawful acts continue, he wrote. Especially because Prince Osaka is our commander, military discipline and morals must be that much more strictly maintained. Anyone who misconducts himself must be severely punished. On New Year's Day, Matsui was still upset about the behavior of the Japanese soldiers at Nanking. Over a toast, he confided to a Japanese diplomat, "My men have done something very wrong and extremely regrettable." But the raping went on, and the killing went on. Matsui seemed incapable of stopping it. If one can believe the story Matsui told years later, his brief visit to Nanking even reduced him to tears in front of his colleagues. Immediately after the memorial services, one assembled the higher officers and wept tears of anger before them, Matsui told his Buddhist confessor before his hanging in 1948. Both Prince Asaka and Lieutenant General Yanagawa were there. "I told them everything had been lost in one moment through the brutalities of the soldiers. And can you imagine it? Even after that, those soldiers laughed at me. The comfort women." The legacy of Nanking. One of the most bizarre consequences of the wholesale rape that took place at Nanking was the response of the Japanese government to the massive outcry from Western nations. Rather than stifle or punish the soldiers responsible, the Japanese high command made plans to create a giant underground system of military prostitution, one that would draw into its web hundreds of thousands of women across Asia. The Japanese Expeditionary Force in central China issued an order to set up comfort houses during this period of time. Yoshimi Yoshiaki, a prominent history professor at Chuo University, observes, "Because Japan was afraid of criticism from China, the United States of America and Europe, following the cases of massive rapes between battles in Shanghai and Nanking, the plan was straightforward. By luring, purchasing, or kidnapping between 80,000 and 200,000 women, most of them from the Japanese colony of Korea but many also from China, Taiwan, the Philippines, and Indonesia, the Japanese military hoped to reduce the incidence of 6 weeks of terror, 53. Random rape of local women, thereby diminishing the opportunity for international criticism to contain sexually transmitted diseases through the use of condoms, and to reward soldiers for fighting on the battlefront for long stretches of time. Later, of course, when the world learned of this plan, the Japanese government refused to acknowledge responsibility, insisting for decades afterwards that private entrepreneurs, not the imperial government, ran the wartime military brothels. But in 1991, Yoshimi Yoshiaki unearthed from the Japanese Defense Agency's archives a document entitled "Regarding the Recruitment of Women for Military Brothels." The document bore the personal stamps of leaders from the Japanese high command and contained orders for the immediate construction of facilities of sexual comfort to stop troops from raping women in regions they controlled in China. The first official comfort house opened near Nanking in 1938. To use the word comfort in regard to either the women or the houses in which they lived is ludicrous, for it conjures up spa images of beautiful geisha girls strumming lutes, washing men, and giving them shiatsu massages. In reality, the conditions of these brothels were sordid beyond the imagination of most civilized people. Untold numbers of these women, whom the Japanese called public toilets, took their own lives when they learned their destiny. Others died from disease or murder. Those who survived suffered a lifetime of shame and isolation, sterility, or mind health. Because most of the victims came from cultures that idealized chastity in women, even those who survived rarely spoke after the war, most not until very recently, about their experiences for fear of facing more shame and derision. Asian Confucianism, particularly Korean Confucianism, upheld female purity as a virtue greater than life and perpetuated the belief that any woman who could live through such a degrading experience and not commit suicide was herself an affront to society. Hence, half a century passed before a few of the comfort women found the courage to break their silence and to seek financial compensation from the Japanese government for their suffering. The motives behind Nanking. Now, we come to the most disturbing question of all, the state of the Japanese mind in Nanking. What was inside the mind of the teenage soldier, handed a rifle and bayonet, that propelled him to commit such atrocities? Many scholars have wrestled with this question and found it almost impossible to answer. Theodore Cook, who co-authored the book Japan at War, an oral history with his wife Hukotaya Cook, admits that the brutality of the rape of Nanking baffles him. he finds no parallels in the history of civil war in Japan. Rather, systematic destruction and mass slaughter of urban populations appear to be part of Mongol rather than Japanese history. Trying to examine the mindset of the Japanese at Nanking, he said, was like peering into a black hole. Many find it difficult to reconcile the barbarism of Nanking with the exquisite politeness and good manners for which the Japanese are renowned. But certain military experts believe that these two seemingly separate behaviors are in reality entwined. They point to the awesome status of the ancient samurai, who for centuries possessed the power to lop off the head of a peasant if he failed to give the warrior a polite answer to his questions. To this day, an American naval intelligence officer wrote of Japanese culture, "During World War II, the Japanese idea of a polite answer is one satisfactory to the questioner." Is it surprising that good manners are a national trait with the Japanese? Other experts have attributed Japanese wartime atrocities to Japanese culture itself. In her book The Chrysanthemum and the Sword, the American anthropologist Ruth Benedict wrote that because moral obligations in Japanese society were not universal, but local and particularized, they could be easily broken on foreign soil. Other experts blame the non-Christian nature of Japanese religion, claiming that while Christianity puts forth the idea that all humans are brothers, indeed, that all things were created in God's image, Shintoism in Japan purports that only the emperor and his descendants were created in God's image. Citing such differences, these experts have con 6 weeks of terror 55 alluded that some cultures, however sophisticated they become, remain at their core tribal, in that the obligations the individual owes to others within the tribe are very different from those owed to outsiders. There is an inherent danger in this assumption, for it has two implications. One, that the Japanese, by virtue of their religion, are naturally less humane than Western cultures, and must be judged by different standards. An implication I find both irresponsible and condescending. And two, that Judeo-Christian cultures are somehow less capable of perpetrating atrocities like the rape of Nanking. Certainly Nazis in Germany, a devoutly Christian country, found a way in the 1930s and 1940s to dehumanize the German psyche and even demonize peoples they had declared to be enemies of the Germans. What resulted were some of the worst crimes against humanity this planet has ever seen. Looking back upon millennia of history, it appears clear that no race or culture has a monopoly on wartime cruelty. The veneer of civilization seems to be exceedingly thin, one that can be easily stripped away, especially by the stresses of war. How then do we explain the raw brutality carried out day after day in the city of Nanking? Unlike their Nazi counterparts, who have mostly perished in prisons and before execution squads, or if alive, are spending their remaining days as fugitives from the law, many of the Japanese war criminals are still alive, living in peace and comfort, protected by the Japanese government. They are therefore some of the few people on this planet who, without concern for retaliation in a court of international law, can give authors and journalists a glimpse of their thoughts and feelings while committing World War II atrocities. Here is what we learn. The Japanese soldier was not simply hardened for battle in China. He was hardened for the task of murdering Chinese combatants and non-combatants alike. Indeed, various games and exercises were set up by the Japanese military to numb its men to the human instinct against killing people who are not attacking. For example, on their way to the capital, Japanese soldiers were made to participate in killing competitions, which were avidly covered by the Japanese media, like sporting events. The most notorious one appeared in the December 7th issue of the Japan Advertiser, under the headline "Sub-Lieutenants in Race to Fell 100 Chinese Running Close Contest." Sub-Lieutenant Mukai Toshiaki and Sub-Lieutenant Noda Takeshi, both of the Katagiri unit at Kuyang, in a friendly contest to see which of them will first fell 100 Chinese in individual sword combat before the Japanese forces completely occupy Nanking, are well in the final phase of their race run. Ning almost neck to neck. On Sunday left bracket December 5th right bracket, the score, according to the Asahi, was Sub-Lieutenant Mukai, 89, and Sub-Lieutenant Noda, 78. A week later, the paper reported that neither man could decide who had passed the 100 mark first, so they upped the goal to 150. Mukai's blade was slightly damaged in the competition, the Japan Advertiser reported. He explained that this was the result of cutting a Chinese in half, helmet and all. The contest was fun, he declared. Such atrocities were not unique to the Nanking area. Rather, they were typical of the desensitization exercises practiced by the Japanese across China during the entire war. The following testimony by a Japanese private named Tajima is not unusual. One day, Second Lieutenant Ono said to us, "You have never killed anyone yet, so today we shall have some killing practice. You must not consider the Chinese as a human being, but only as something of rather less value than a dog or cat. Be brave. Now, those who wish to volunteer for killing practice, step forward." No one moved. The lieutenant lost his temper. "You cowards," he shouted. "Not one of you is fit to call himself a Japanese soldier. So no one will volunteer. Well then, I'll order you." And he began to call out names, Otani Furukawa, Wano Tajima. "My God, me too." One raised my bayoneted gun with trembling hands and, directed by the lieutenant's almost hysterical cursing, I walked slowly towards the terror-stricken Chinese standing beside the 6 weeks of terror, 57 pit, the grave he had helped to dig. In my heart, I begged his pardon, and, with my eyes shut and the lieutenant's curses in my ears, I plunged the bayonet into the petrified Chinese. When I opened my eyes again, he had slumped down into the pit. "Murderer. Criminal," I called myself. For new soldiers, horror was a natural impulse. One Japan as Wartime memoir describes how a group of green Japanese recruits failed to conceal their shock when they witnessed Seasone soldiers torture a group of civilians to death. Their commander expected this reaction and wrote in his diary, "All new recruits are like this, but soon they will be doing the same things themselves." But new officers also required desensitization. A veteran of Pfizer named Tominaga Shozo recalled vividly his own transformation from innocent youth to killing machine. Tominaga had been a fresh second lieutenant from a military academy when assigned to the 232nd Regiment of the 39th Division from Hiroshima. When he was introduced to the men under his command, Tominaga was stunned. They had evil eyes, he remembered. They weren't human eyes, but the eyes of leopards or tigers. On the front, Tominaga and other new candidate officers underwent intensive training to stiffen their endurance for war. In the program, an instructor had pointed to a thin, emaciated Chinese in a detention center and told the officers, "These are the raw materials for your trial of courage." Day after day, the instructor taught them how to cut off heads and bayonet living prisoners. On the final day, we were taken out to the site of our trial. 24 prisoners were squatting there with their hands tied behind their backs. They were blindfolded. A big hole had been dug 10 meters long, 2 meters wide, and more than 3 meters deep. The regimental commander, the battalion commanders, and the company commanders all took the seats arranged for them. Second Lieutenant Tanaka bowed to the regimental commander and reported, "We shall now begin." He ordered a soldier on fatigue duty to haul one of the prisoners to the edge of the pit. The prisoner was kicked when he resisted. The soldiers finally dragged him over and forced him to his knees. Tanaka turned toward us and looked into each of our faces in turn. "Heads should be cut off like this," he said, unsheathing his army sword. He scooped water from a bucket with a dipper, then poured it over both sides of the blade. Swishing off the water, he raised his sword in a long arc. Standing behind the prisoner, Tanaka steadied himself, legs spread apart, and cut off the man's head with a shout, "Yo!" The head flew more than a meter away. Blood spurted up in two fountains from the body and sprayed into the hole. The scene was so appalling that I felt I couldn't breathe. But gradually, Tominaga Shozo learned to kill. And as he grew more adept at it, he no longer felt that his men's eyes were evil. For him, atrocities became routine, almost banal. Looking back on his experience, he wrote, "We made them like this. Good sons, good daddies, good elder brothers at home were brought to the front to kill each other. Human beings turned into murdering demons. Everyone became a demon within 3 months. Some Japanese soldiers admitted it was easy for them to kill because they had been taught that next to the emperor, all individual life, even their own, was valueless. Azuma Shiro, the Japanese soldier who witnessed a series of atrocities in Nanking, made an excellent point about his comrade's behavior in his letter to me. During his 2 years of military training in the 20th Infantry Regiment of Kyoto Fufuku Chiyama, he was taught that loyalty is heavier than a mountain and our life is lighter than a feather. He recalled that the highest honor a soldier could achieve during war was to come back dead. To die for the emperor was the greatest glory, to be caught alive by the enemy the greatest shame. If my life was not important, Azuma wrote to me, an enemy's life became inevitably much less important. This philosophy led us to look down on the enemy and eventually to the mass murder and ill treatment of the captives. In interview after interview, Japanese veterans from the Nanking massacre reported honestly that they experienced a 6 weeks of terror, 59 complete lack of remorse or sense of wrongdoing, even when torturing helpless civilians. Nagatomi Hakuto spoke candidly about his emotions in the fallen capital. I remember being driven in a truck along a path that had been cleared through piles of thousands and thousands of slaughtered bodies. Wild dogs were gnawing at the dead flesh as we stopped and pulled a group of Chinese prisoners out of the back. Then the Japanese officer proposed a test of my courage. He unsheathed his sword, spat on it, and with a sudden mighty swing, he brought it down on the neck of a Chinese boy cowering before us. The head was cut clean off and tumbled away on the group as the body slumped forward, blood spurting in two great gushing fountains from the neck. The officer suggested I take the head home as a souvenir. I remember smiling proudly as I took his sword and began killing people. After almost 60 years of soul searching, Nagatomi is a changed man. A doctor in Japan, he has built a shrine of remorse in his waiting room. Patients can watch videotapes of his trial in Nanking and a full confession of his crimes. The gentle and hospitable demeanor of the doctor belies the horror of his past, making it almost impossible for one to imagine that he had once been a ruthless murderer. Few know that soldiers impaled babies on bayonets and tossed them still alive into pots of boiling water, Nagatomi said. They gang-raped women from the ages of 12 to 80 and then killed them when they could no longer satisfy sexual requirements. I beheaded people, starved them to death, burned them, and buried them alive, over 200 in all. It is terrible that I could turn into an animal and do these things. There are really no words to explain what I was doing. I was truly a devil. The fall of Nanking Kanking. A city long celebrated as one of China's greatest literary, artistic, and political centers, a city that served as the ancient capital of China from the 3rd century to the 6th, and then intermittently after the 14th century. It was in Nanking that the canons of Chinese calligraphy and painting were set, that the four-tone system of the Chinese language was established, that some of the most famous Buddhist scriptures were edited and transcribed, and from which the classic Six Dynasties essay style, a blending of Chinese poetry and prose, emerged. It was in Nanking, in 1842, that the treaty ending the Opium Wars was signed, opening China to foreign trade. And it was in Nanking, in 1911, that the nationalist leader Sun Yat-sen became the first provisional president of his nascent Republic of China. Today it proudly holds his tomb. Mention the name Nanking to any Chinese, and he or she will draw you a picture of a city filled with ancient imperial palaces, lavish tombs, museums, and memorials. The picture would include the intricately carved stone statues of warriors and animals built during the Ming Dynasty. The famous drum tower Marco Polo saw the original one 700 years ago. The modern version was built 3 centuries later by a military leader who beat a huge drum from the tower to signal his soldiers, and the scenery on the outskirts of Nanking, temples perched on nearby mountains and hills, tea pavilions and lotus blossoms on its lakes, a massive bridge spanning the Yangtze River. For centuries, water and mountain provided not only beauty for Nanking but military protection. The Yangtze River to the west and the Purple Mountain to the east shielded the city like a coiling dragon and a crouching tiger, to borrow an ancient phrase describing Nanking's natural strength. But sadly, 3 times Nanking has been an invaded city. The first invasion occurred more than a millennium ago, at the end of the 6th century, when barbarian hordes demolished every important building in the city and even plowed up the land inside the walls. The second came more than 1,000 years later, between 1853 and 1864, when the Taiping rebels captured the city. They were led by the fanatical leader Hong Zhuquan, who, after failing scholarly examinations that would have guaranteed him a place in the nation's elite, convinced himself and others that he was the younger brother of Jesus Christ. The attempt he then spearheaded to overthrow the Qing dynasty eventually killed some 20 million Chinese over 13 years. The rebels used Nanking as their capital for more than a decade, until they were driven out, at which time they reduced the city to smoldering ruins and even smashed the porcelain pagoda.